Hey everybody, I'm John Luke, pastor of Salem. Welcome in the name of Jesus for this time of worship. Today is the last Sunday of the Christian year, the Christian calendar, and it's called Christ the King Sunday, or also Reign of Christ. We're celebrating the reign of Jesus Christ. Today we are also concluding our series as we've been telling more stories by Jesus about what the kingdom of heaven will be like. And so we're at the end of Matthew chapter 25, and we're hearing another story, this one about sheep and goats. I'm really pleased to tell you we have a guest preacher today, Reverend Kristina Roth-Klinck. She's a new pastor here in Cedar Rapids this year. She grew up in Iowa. She's the daughter of a United Methodist pastor here in the Iowa Conference. And after studying at Simpson College, she taught third grade here in Iowa, in Fairfield, before then moving to Dallas, Texas. That's where she attended Perkins School of Theology. There she lived in intentional Christian community with the Missional Wisdom Foundation. She was doing ministry with the Homeless Friends in East Dallas. Kristina has a passion for church revitalization, how we can use our church buildings in creative ways. Finishing up her last year of seminary, Kristina interned at Missional Wisdom Foundation and White Rock United Methodist Church, both of which are finding new ways to do ministry, using the building in creative ways and starting a new missional church start. Kristina is a commissioned elder appointed to Lovely Lane United Methodist Church here in Cedar Rapids as their associate pastor, and she is also serving at Matthew 25 as the spiritual cultivator, starting up diverse, progressive micro expressions of faith. Her husband is a native Texan. He's also a graduate from Perkins School of Theology. Ryan is a spiritual director and currently does ministry in a bivocational way. He's working full-time at New Pioneer Co-op. Thanks for joining with us for worship today. I want to encourage you to connect with us. A great place to take your next step is at salemchurch.life. Also, I want to invite you to share this worship video with others. It's usually as easy as a click to share Jesus. Welcome.
In God's kingdom, He wants all of us to care for those in need, the sick, the poor, the hungry, and for us to be the body of Christ. So let's sing this out. Body. Will you please pray with me? All-powerful God, your only Son came to earth in the form of a slave and is now enthroned at your right hand, where he rules in glory. As he reigns as King in our hearts, may we rejoice in his peace, glory in his justice, and live in his love. For with you and the Holy Spirit, he rules now and forever. Amen.
Our scripture text this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25, verses 31 through 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people from one another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me." Then he will say to those at his left hand, "You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry, or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not take care of you?" Then he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Will you pray with me? Loving and gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Looking out the window, I saw tents with colorful fabrics, animals, outdoor stoves, and children with smudges on their faces and tattered clothing. This was the image I saw out the window on the bus ride through the Judean desert, through the wilderness, as we made our way west for a day at Masada, the Dead Sea, the baptismal site of Jesus, and Qumran, the place where the Dead Sea Scrolls were found. And as I looked out the window at the vastly expansive desert, what I saw were the Bedouin communities on the side of the road. I saw their villages, their homes, shepherds out herding sheep and goats, and children playing with one another. The word Bedouin comes from an Arabic word meaning desert dweller, and they share a common culture of shepherding, herding camels, goats, and sheep. And as I read the scripture for today, I was struck not by the language of sheep and goats, but to the shepherd, remembering my experience in Israel earlier last year. So this morning, as we explore this scripture, I want us to focus on the image of the shepherd, Our text today is the final judgment. When the Son of Man comes in all his glory, he will separate people from one another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. All throughout Scripture, Jesus refers to himself as a shepherd. In the Gospel of John, Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep." Or we see in Isaiah, "Like a shepherd, he will tend his flock." And here in our text today, Jesus is the shepherd who will separate the people when he returns in his glory. When Jesus returns, he will separate the people to his left and to his right, like a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. Those at the right of the shepherd will have eternal life, for they fed the hungry, welcomed in the stranger, clothed the naked, took care of the sick, and visited those in prison. And every time they did these things, they cared for the least of these. They cared for Jesus. And to those at the left, Jesus will say, "You will receive punishment, for you did not feed the hungry, did not welcome in the stranger, did not clothe the naked, did not take care of the sick, and did not visit those in prison." Each time was an opportunity to minister to Jesus, and each time they failed to serve Jesus, the one directly in front of them. By saying he is the shepherd, Jesus gives us clues as to who exactly we should be caring for. These modern-day shepherds, these Bedouin communities, are actually not so modern. They have been the shepherds of this whole region for thousands of years. Father Abraham was a Bedouin. So all throughout Scripture, when there is reference to shepherding, it's reference to the Bedouin community. By saying he is the shepherd, Jesus is saying that he is a Bedouin. Last week, I was messaging with my friend Hail, who lives in Israeli territory in Nazareth. And Hail and his family own a restaurant there in Nazareth, the city where Jesus grew up. Hail was telling me more about the Bedouin community in preparation for this sermon. Hail shared with me that the Bedouin communities live in extreme poverty. They actually live a lot like their ancestors did. 85% of all Bedouins live in the Negev Desert, live below the line of poverty, which is the case for many Bedouin communities throughout Israel and other nearby nations. These alarming rates of poverty are due mostly because of state-enforced policies. And when I asked Kyle to tell me about marginalization, he said, "They are absolutely marginalized, not only in Israel, but they are ignored by governments all over the region." And the people who live there, Hill said, these people ignore them too. They completely look down at the Bedouins. Israel refuses to recognize the vast majority of Bedouin villages. So these villages continue to go without electricity, running water, roads, or sewage systems. In a recent article highlighting the struggles that the pandemic has had in the Bedouin community, one family is struggling to feed the family. The mother makes 35 pitas every 2 days and shakshuka with tomatoes. They can never afford meat. So this text clearly lays out what we must do as Christians. We must feed the hungry, welcome in the stranger, clothe the naked, care for the sick, and visit those in prison. And every time we do these things, we are also directly doing these things for and to Jesus, a Bedouin living in extreme poverty. As we think about this text, we might say, well, I feed the hungry. I volunteer at a soup kitchen once a month, and I give away my expired cans of beans and vegetables. I go through my closet every year and give away the clothes with holes or faded jeans. I give money out the window to the homeless person with a cardboard sign. These might be the things that those on the left would tell Jesus after he tells them, "You are accursed. Just as you did not do it for one of least of these, you did not do it for me." Jesus is calling us for more, to be in friendship with those living on the margins. Who are the Bedouins in our country, in our city? Who are the people that Jesus is calling us to care for? We have certainly had a difficult year. I think I will be truly grateful for January 1st and 2021. This year we have faced a pandemic that we just can't get under control in a country that is so divided that wearing a mask seems like a political statement. And in our own county in Iowa, as of Wednesday afternoon, when we preached and recorded the sermon, there have been 12,280 cases of COVID-19 and 150 deaths. Some of you have had COVID-19, and many of you may have lost your dear friends and family due to this very aggressive pandemic. And here in Iowa, just a few months ago, a destructive land hurricane tore through our city, leaving many homeless and some unsure how they'll pay to fix their homes. Some African communities were living in tents again, bringing back horrible memories of living in oppression. Certainly, in our own city, there are Bedouins in our community who are being marginalized and looked down upon. Mr. Rogers used to tell children on TV that his mother responded to scary news by telling him to look for the helpers. And as we have faced so much struggle this year in our community, we can, too, look for the helpers. One such helper that has made sacrifices and bent over backwards for the community is Matthew 25, not the scripture, the nonprofit. When the derecho hit, Matthew 25 responded in love, getting out over 60 generators to those who are vulnerable due to age or medical reasons. We walked the neighborhoods with volunteers from around the community, surveying homeowners in the city on any help that they needed from the derecho. Matthew 25 devoted a week for repairing projects in the community due to the storm, many projects that would not be covered by insurance. Taking on the scripture that is its name, Matthew 25 sees its work as investing in the talents of a neighborhood. And like the Bedouin communities, many communities in Cedar Rapids have often been neglected by the city and area neighborhoods. One such community, a local trailer park, was neglected during derecho cleanup. And during Transform this past August, I walked the trailer park neighborhood with our executive director. And we met a young little boy, 8 years old, who said, "No one has come till now. No one has come to help us. And you all have been here all week long." This little 8-year-old boy, and he gets it. He gets that he is marginalized, and likely in his life of just 8 years, he has been forgotten like the Bedouin community. Matthew 25 sees the talents and the skills of the people in the neighborhood, working to build relationships, cultivating mutuality and friendship on the margins. And here in Linn County, we can look for the helpers who continue to spend 12, 14, 16 plus hour days to fight this pandemic. These doctors, nurses, healthcare practitioners, and Linn County Public Health. We need to continue to provide praise and encouragement for these people as they continue to put in hours and hours to keep us all safe. While in Israel, we got to experience one of the seven wonders of the world, walking through Petra, the ancient archaeological site in Jordan. We all certainly got our Indiana Jones moment as we walked up to the treasury. And as my friends and I were exploring one of the buildings of stone, my friend Macy began to sing. Her voice bounced all over the inside of the stone. And as she continued to sing, a young Bedouin girl walked into the cave in awe of Macy's singing. She looked at her, pointed at her, and called her beautiful in Arabic, Jamaleh. My friend Ashley began to talk with her a little bit of English and a little bit of Arabic. And this family owned a little jewelry store within the ancient city of Petra. And this young girl gave Ashley a bracelet, a beautiful beaded red bracelet. And Ashley's heart felt heavy, but she didn't have anything to give in return. But this girl didn't want anything in return. She simply wanted to give out of her generosity. I spoke with Ashley earlier this week, who gave me permission to tell this story, and she remembered that I had said that the gift for the Bedouin girl was simply in accepting the bracelet. She likely did not have a lot of opportunities to give others something and was likely always on the receiving end. When we got back to the United States, Ashley continued to think about the young Bedouin girl and wanted to see her again. So when Ashley's roommate was going back to Jordan, she sent her with a picture, a letter in Arabic, and a love necklace for the young girl. Well, lo and behold, the tour guide knew this family, and they were able to give the girl her gift. Ashley describes this experience as a special spiritual moment. For her, there was a connection between the two of them that she can never describe in words. However, she did say that this experience with the Bedouin girl was philo love, friendship love. And the Bedouin community is majority Muslim. So this experience, this connection, stretched across boundaries. Love has no boundaries. And in Ashley's words, Jesus didn't say to love your religion, but to love the world. He said we need to grow comfortable in being uncomfortable and reaching out to build relationships, reaching out to bring hope in the community. In this scripture, hope is in building relationships with the most vulnerable, building relationships, friendships with those on the margins. And as we can see in this text, Jesus is the Bedouin community that yearns for building relationships and connections. And we can see that Jesus calls us to more than just giving out our old clothes, the expired food in our pantry, or even giving out soup on the serving side. But Jesus calls us into moving to philo love, friendship with those that are living on the margins, to bring hope to our community. In the name of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen.
Would you pray with me? Lord, we pray for your kingdom to come, here on earth as it is in heaven. Show us what you're doing, Lord, and allow us to be a part of it. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for those who lack the basic necessities of life. Open our eyes to the hungry, the thirsty, the strangers, those who are naked, sick, and in prison. Help us to care for them as we would care for you. Bless and strengthen our Matthew 25 ministry and all those who willingly share the resources God has given to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and honor your presence in all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all in the path or the wake of the novel coronavirus as cases, hospitalizations, and deaths continue to grow in our county, our state, and our nation. As hospitals are running out of room, as those testing positive are having further health issues down the road, as some of us who are called to love our neighbors struggle with wearing a mask and washing hands and distancing and staying out of larger groups. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for ourselves, our families, and those we love, especially the family and friends of our dear sister Evelyn Dunick, whose funeral service was last week. The family and friends of Lee Smith, a former long-serving secretary at Salem, whose funeral was last week. Bob and Grace Thompson, who are moving next week to Stony Point Meadows. Please pray for health and peace during this transition in their lives. Orlie Hollingworth's nephew, Dennis Hargrave, and his family who have COVID. Brian, Jan, and Kyle Martin, who all have COVID. Frank Conrad, who has been diagnosed with lung cancer and will start radiation treatment next week. And let us pray now for those we lift up to the Lord silently in our hearts and minds, and for those we lift up aloud with our voices. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, through Jesus Christ, you have shown us the sovereignty of divine love and compassion for the least, the lost, and the lonely. Almighty God, confirm our prayer with the dedication of our lives to Matthew 25 ministry. In the name of Jesus, the one and only true King, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever, and who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns a music but its own. Awake, my soul, and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king throughout eternity. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring and lives that death may die. Crown him the Lord of peace, whose power a scepter sways, from pole to pole that wars may cease, and all be prayer and praise. His reign shall know no end, and round his pierced feet fair flowers of paradise extend their fragrance ever sweet. Crown him the Lord of love, behold his hands and side, those wounds yet visible above in beauty glorified. All hail, Redeemer, hail, for thou hast died for me. Thy praise and glory shall not fail throughout eternity.
Thanks for gathering with us today for this time of worship. I want to invite you to join us again next week, and of course, encourage you to follow us on social media, check in with us at salemchurch.life. That's a great place to take your next step. And as always, I want to encourage you to share this video with others. It's as easy as a click to share Jesus with others. Also, if you receive a DVD of the worship service, you could pass that along to someone else as well. I want to say thank you to Reverend Kristina Roth-Klinck. She's from Lovely Lane, and Matthew 25 for sharing that word of the Lord today. Now, I hope you have a wonderful and a safe Thanksgiving this week, and especially in light of the pandemic and for the struggles that we're all having and sort of making our decisions about how we handle that in a safe way. Please, please be safe. Next week, believe it or not, is the beginning of Advent. It's the first Sunday of Advent, and we begin that journey of waiting for Jesus to come, and how appropriate that is. I mean, we've just been living that this whole year. We're waiting for God to do something. We're waiting for God's peace, for God's wholeness and health and well-being and joy and beauty and justice and salvation. We're waiting for all of that. So we begin the waiting for Christmas, for Jesus to come, as Jesus has already come, to come again. Receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.